All right, here we are. Okay. Hey, everybody. My name is Claire Kessler. You can call me Professor Claire. You can really call me whatever you want. It doesn't really matter to me. Anyways, I'm teaching VITI 308 this year, which is Introduction to Winemaking, Fruit to Wine, Enology, and I am stoked to be here. I'm also stoked to be teaching virtually because I just invested in all this equipment. And now I look like a professional streamer, so I'm very excited about that. Just got a new camera, the quality's great, got my lighting set up, green screen, it's quite the production. Anyways, welcome to the class. I'm very excited for this semester, it's gonna be awesome. For this class, I decided instead of doing Zoom, it'd be much more beneficial for you guys if I had just recorded my lectures beforehand, just like this, and posted them on Canvas for you guys, or made them available. I'm not sure how the storage situation is going to work out, because the videos are like 50 minutes long each, so I might be posting them on YouTube, I don't know. We'll figure it out when we hit that part in the road. But yeah, anyways, I am currently the assistant winemaker at Villa Toscano. I've been there since February of this year, 2020, so pretty new. I've been making wine for 4 years. Now I've been in the industry. I graduated from UC Davis with my bachelor's in viticulture and enology. And then met the dean at the college while I was pouring wine in the tasting room. And here I am now to teach this class. Anyways, my goal for this class is to teach you guys everything that I have learned in my most practical work experience up to this point, and also teaching you the fundamentals of what's taught in the actual class at UC Davis. So you can, you know, rest assured, this is a class that's going to be very high quality, very information packed, and tailored to fit your guys' needs. So it's going to be awesome. So now that my little introduction spiel is over, we'll go over the format of the class, we'll go over the syllabus, we'll walk through Canvas together, and we'll also go through lecture one, which I have displayed on the screen right here. So yes, let's do that. The format of the class, like I said, is going to be recorded lectures, and this is really fantastic because I know everyone's schedule is kind of tossed in the air because of this whole COVID situation. So, you know, you can watch these videos while you're folding laundry. You can watch it at whatever time is most convenient for you. I just ask that you keep up with the class. Make sure that you're not falling too far behind because it is just a video. There will be assignments, and I will make that very obvious on Canvas. And if you have any questions, you can always schedule a Zoom conference with me. And I'd be more than happy to FaceTime or Zoom or a phone call or, you know, 6 foot distance coffee session, totally okay in my books too. So we'll make it work. If you have any needs, just let me know, and we should be ready to rock and roll. Sweet. Okay, so let's do Canvas first, because that's where you'll access all of your information, like the syllabus and the slides and the assignments. That's where you'll submit stuff. It's where you can message me. So basically what you need is a computer with access to internet. And we'll just open a new tab here. If I can find my mouse. Oh, there it is. Okay, cool. Okay, so you just open up a new tab. Google, you know, Firefox, whatever you use. Then you're going to go to Los Rios Single Sign-On. Oops. Here we go. Sweet. And this is a portal for you to, you know, reach your Gmail, Canvas, any your class registration, all that wonderful stuff. So you'll click on to Los Rios Single Sign-On. Boom. Takes you to that page. Fantastic. You need to log in first, though, so let me log out. So I'm already logged in. Oh, okay. Never mind. Anyways, for the login, it's pretty simple. It's W, your student ID. So letter W, and then your student ID, whatever those digits are, and then your password. If you need to set a password, you can create a password. It's pretty simple. If you need help, let me know. It's totally fine. Okay, so what we're going to be using for this class is Canvas. So that is right here. And when you click on that, boop, you you get your dashboard. And your dashboard will look different to mine because you're not just taking my class, or maybe you are, and that's fine too. But it will list all of the courses that you're signed up for, that you've paid for. So there's two different squares for my course. There's a lecture and a lab. I'll just be posting and whatever according, but I will send you messages, of course, you know, when there's assignments and such. So we're in the lecture portion right now. We're not in lab. So you go ahead and open up lecture. There's my little introduction spiel about me, and I kind of just covered everything that's already written there. If you want to read it, you're more than welcome to. Then we're going to go down to files, and this is where all the good stuff is. So you see the syllabus is right here, and then we have lecture videos, lecture slides, and then course images. You don't need to worry about that. So let's go ahead and open up the syllabus. And you can print this out, write on it, keep it, whatever you want to do. Okay, cool. So, there is my email right here at the top. The class is VITI 308, Fruit to Wine. It's my email. Our schedule is Monday and Wednesday, 6 to 6:50 p.m. And the class runs from August 22nd to December 17th. Objectives. So what's the point of this class? What are we doing here? What are any of us doing here? We want to increase understanding and experience in winemaking through the lens of all practical, chemical, biological, and artistic backgrounds. No various winemaking styles and how to implement them. Understanding wine measurements, including pH, titratable acidity, SO2, the different types of SO2, free, bound, and total, and how each one affects wine. Don't be intimidated if you're not a chemistry major. We're going to go over it. There's no prerequisite for this class, and I'm here to help you learn. So I've had people before in this class that have taken absolutely no chemistry, and they did just fine. So don't be intimidated. Put in the work, and you'll be fine. It's not that bad, I promise. Learn how to identify wine spoilage and where it comes from. So we're going to talk about Brett, volatile acidity, TCA, which is just the scientific compound for corked wine, TCA, trichloroanisole is what it's called. Understand what wine quality is to you and how the general public sees wine quality. This is extremely important for all winemakers. The definition of wine quality for some people might be the best wine for the best price. For some people, it might be the absolute best products that you've put into the wine, no matter what the cost is, if it was held to a certain standard and made a certain way. Some people, it's sentimental wine quality, you know, like this wine is the best because this is what my father drank, or, you know, I grew up with this in the house, or I only drink Italian wines, you know. Anyways, we'll get into it. It's very important. It's also really important to know when you become a winemaker, you're not just making wine for yourself, you're making wine for the public. And you need to understand what that quality means to them to make that and to sell that. It's very much a business and an art and a science. So we'll go over that. Next, expectations. Stay with the class schedule and do not fall behind. If you fall behind, it's going to get really hard. So just watch the video. It's twice a week. You know, I'm here for you. I work another job as a winemaker, but it's my job to be here for you too. So reach out to me. Talk to someone, watch the videos with someone. That might be fun to do when you come home from work. If you have a significant other or a friend who wants, you know, who's interested in wine, watch it together, talk about it. Totally cool with that. No problem with that. Don't be shy. Communicate any questions, concerns, or needs. I feel like we went over that, so we're good. Be respectful and kind to both me and other students in the class. If for some reason you're in contact with students in the class, please don't harass them. Please be nice. Please be respectful. As well as to me, because, you know, it's not nice when people are mean. Not a good day. Okay, class layout. Okay, lectures will either be recorded and posted for you, or they'll be through Zoom. I think I'm going to go the recording route, but we'll see how it goes this semester. The end of each lecture contains 10 review questions that are similar in format to what will be on the test. This is fantastic. This is a wonderful thing. I love it. Love it so much because when I was in college, which wasn't that long ago, I knew I would study for an exam, and you might have come stumbled upon this problem too. Study for an exam, and you know you got the info down, you made flashcards, you know, you read the chapters, you were there for every lecture. You get there for the test, and it's a completely different format that just blows you off, just totally off course, and you just, like, flunk it. You're just like, I was not prepared for that. If I had just known the format, if I had known, you know, the type of questions that were going to be on that exam, I'd be more prepared. I studied the wrong parts. So that's what these questions at the end of my lectures are geared for. They're geared to get you prepared and ready for the exam. So and they're also to help ensure that you're taking away from the lecture what you should be. So that way you avoid overdoing it and, like, committing way too much time to studying and or underdoing it where you're not doing enough. So it kind of keeps you in check, which is fantastic. Exams will be most of your grade. I'll have 4 exams. I'll try to have 4. We'll see how the schedule goes. I'll drop the lowest score and keep the remaining 3 for your grade. So the format is multiple choice and short answer, and you will need a calculator. There also will be a research paper for this class. So I used to do presentations, but since we're doing distance learning, you're going to have to do it on your own, kind of, with this research paper. You're going to write about a wine region or wine style. We're going to go over this in the class, so don't worry. This will be a 3-page paper that will include scholarly or authentic sources, and I'll provide the topics. If you have an idea, something that you'd like to do, just run it by me first. Let me give you the okay to make sure you're on the right track, and you can totally do that. That's totally fine. And then those research papers will be peer-reviewed. So the point of the presentation was to teach each other more about wine, and since we can't present to each other, you'll have to peer-review, you know, a couple of your other students' research papers. So that way, you know, you learn about a subject, then you can learn what they had written about too. So it'll be fun. Next is wine tasting, the reason you all took this class in reality. Cough, cough. It's fun. It's a lot of fun. A little disclaimer though, make sure you're being safe. Please don't drink and drive. Please don't drink if you're pregnant. And please don't drink if it makes you irrationally mad and destroy things. That would be awesome. So there will actually be a lab sign release form that you guys will have to submit. I'll get that posted. We'll figure that out. Again, new thing this year with the school, with COVID. So we'll get that done. But yeah, please be safe. The drinking, you know, do a respectful amount. Do it in the, you know, privacy and safety of your own home, please. And yeah, and it should be good. That's the only way that we're going to learn is through, studying and tasting. It's one thing to know the textbook and the styles and the technicality, but it really is an art too. And you need to be able to train your taste buds to really understand what you're working with. So that's the point there. The wine tastings will be a little bit of write-ups. Creating some charts is nothing, it's nothing really intense. You'll have the freedom of what wines you want to taste and how much you want to spend on the wine. But participation is mandatory and does count as credit towards your grade. So there's that. What you're going to need, you'll need a calculator. You'll need a textbook, which is Principles and Practices of Winemaking, which is this guy. Oh, you can't see it because the green screen. That's hilarious. Anyways, it's a green book. It says Principles and Practices of Winemaking. It's pretty thick. And it's by Roger Bolton, Vernon Singleton, Linda Basson, Ralph Kunkey. These are actually head researchers and professors at UC Davis. And they are still alive, yes. And this is basically the Bible of winemaking. This is extremely important. So, you know, I definitely, if it's going to put you through a financial hardship, don't get the textbook. You know, you're going to be fine. You can still pass the class off the textbook. You might miss out on some really valuable information and a couple of assignment points. But honestly, I definitely recommend it 110% though. Literally everything you could want to know that you can't find online. And I'll tell you that because I tried. Recommended textbook would be Wine Folly. If you don't know Wine Folly, it's fantastic. Madeline Puckett is really cool. I do have a bone to pick with her, though, because she steals a lot of information from Davis and doesn't credit them in her work. So, don't be like Madeline Puckett. When if you are very successful, please give credit to the people who actually did the research. That'd be great. I was actually in a class at Davis, and she came in and had questions for my professor. So, yeah, that happened. Don't do that. Okay, grading scale is pretty basic. 90% and above is an A. A B, 80 to 89.99%, you know, etc. If you're getting less than 59%, we need to talk. So, don't put that off to the end. Hopefully we'll figure it out. Okay, grading breakdown. There's some iffy room here. 80% are exams. Drop the lowest score for exams. 10 to 20% will be labs, homework, participation, and quizzes. So, really, it's the tests is when you really need to shine. And the tests, as we already know, really mirror the questions that are at the end of the lecture. So, you know, keep up, ask questions, and you should be fine, honestly. Like, I'm not here to punish anyone. I'm here to help you learn. I hate teachers that are here to punish and, like, shame you. No, if you don't know something, it's fine. Don't be upset. It's okay. I don't know everything. I'm not going to know everything. I'm never going to know everything, especially about wines. Endless things to learn, but don't be ashamed. It's totally cool. Okay. Learning accommodations. If you have social accommodations, just come to me. If you ask, you shall receive. Communication is very important. So check your Canvas website often. Assignments, lecture notes, quizzes, announcements, changes in instructions, grades, new materials will be posted there. There is actually an app for Canvas, if you didn't know, and it's fantastic. Definitely recommend downloading it, so that way, you know, if you're at work or, you know, whatever, you're not at your computer most of the day, you get notifications if I email you, or you can email me through Canvas with that. You can send an email to my work email that's posted on this syllabus as well. You know, you can look at lecture slides through your phone, with the app, so you can study on the go. It's fantastic, and it's free. So if you don't do it, you're really missing out, honestly. Unless you don't have a smartphone, then that's just a bummer. Holidays. We do have holidays. Labor Day, Veterans Day, and Thanksgiving recess. So pay attention. There will not be class. I will not be there, and you should not either. You should be doing something fun. So yeah, that's the syllabus. If you have any questions, email me. And yeah. I think we're good on that. Sweet. Also, another wonderful thing about videos is that you can pause it and take a break anytime you want. It's fantastic. It's fantastic because I have the attention span of a goldfish. So if you're that way too, that's okay. You can take a break. You can hit pause and go get a snack and come back. It's wonderful. It's a wonderful thing. I love it so much. I love it so much. Okay. Moving on. Stay on task. Okay, so with that, I think we're going to move into our first lecture, which is fantastic. For these recordings, I'm probably going to stick to just the lecture and just the lab. And then anything in between assignments, I will post. I'm going to try my best to make a spreadsheet of assignments that are due and when. But since this class is still pretty new, and especially this online format is new, I can't guarantee that that's going to be done soon. But I am pretty understanding and I'm pretty lenient. You know, if you didn't get a message, just let me know. You know, you didn't understand if something was due, you know, I get it, but definitely check your Canvas, you know, whenever you can. And I'll give you plenty of heads up before, stuff's due. At least a week. That's my rule. I'll give you at least a week heads up before something's due. Okay. Awesome. So without further ado, let's go into the slides, shall we? Okay, so starting off with a little lovely pun here. Did you know farmers are the only ones that are truly outstanding in their fields? Little pun from my high school professor there. Okay, I'll start with some terminology. So viticulture is the study of grape cultivation. So if you end up going and getting a degree in viticulture and enology, you'll study both grape cultivation and fermentation science. So viticulture, viti, meaning the vine life, is a a Latin root. That's the it's a grapevine. So it's the soil composition, it's nutrients, it's pest control, integrated pest management. It's much more than just being a farmer. There's a lot of science to it. There's a lot to do. It definitely deserves a lot of respect and awe as well. Enology is the study of wine fermentation science. This is really complex. This is what we're going to go over in the class. It's chemistry, biochemistry, microbiology, chemical engineering, nutrition. Don't get intimidated by that. It's just the many points that we just touch on. We're not going to become, you know, professional neuroscientists here. It's going to be okay. Winemaking is the series of operations from harvesting grapes through providing bottled wine ready for the consumer. So the reason that I give you this definition specifically is at some wineries, there is actually two separate positions for the winemaker and the head enologist. The head enologist does a lot of the measurements and calculations and gives feedback to the winemaker, and then the winemaker will make decisions how to adjust the wine, blends, you know, is the acidity too high, is the pH too high, you know, and goes from there. So there is a difference. In some places where it's a much smaller production, they are the same person. They do everything. Okay, what is wine? It is fermented grape juice containing around 14% alcohol by volume. So that's kind of the baseline definition for wine. It can be made in, you know, very many different styles. There's, you know, red wine, white wine, rosé, dessert style, ice wine, you know, you name it. But, you know, that's the general definition. And it can reach, you know, as low as 13 and up to 16% alcohol by volume, but that's typically it for wine in general. Okay, what about fruit wines? There is such thing as fruit wines besides using grapes. So apple wine is a thing. You can get peach wine, pear wine, blackberry wine, you name it. The only difference in these is that the fruit is treated very similar, but we actually need to add sugar to the fermentation to get that resulting alcohol. So that alcohol is a very important definition for what a wine is. So, you know, the difference here between, I'll get to this in the next slide, with the cider and the fruit wine is that the cider, there is no sugar added to the fermentation to get that higher alcohol at the end. So yeah, very nice. Okay, hard cider, yep, it's just fermented fruit juice. It typically results in 3.5% to 4.5% alcohol by volume. So that's hard cider. Regular cider, according to the Massachusetts Department of Agriculture, says it's just you know, raw apple juice that hasn't undergone filtration to remove any coarse particles of pulp or sediment. So if you go to Boa Vista, High Hill, another Apple Hill farm, get some regular cider, you can give the fun facts to the people there. Okay, wine varieties or varietals. So just to take a step back, the point of this lecture is to just give you a really broad background of wine. A couple definitions to help you understand kind of what's what and what's going on. We'll go over regions a little bit. But anyways, yeah, just want to let you know. I didn't really give you a lowdown at the very beginning of this slideshow. So wine varieties or varietals, technically varieties is correct, but varietals has been so widely accepted in the community that it's just kind of the new slang. So those are different types of wine grapes. So you know, like Grenache, Cabernet Sauvignon, Tempranillo, those are all different varieties of Vitis vinifera or Vitis vinifera, which are grapevines specifically most commonly used for winemaking. And then there's a branch of science called ampelography, which is the study of vine identification by cluster, berry, and leaf shape. So in the days before DNA testing and before everything was so quick and beautiful and easy to understand and know after, you know, just a quick test, there were people that actually specialized in this science, ampelography, and they would go out into a vineyard and they could tell you, identify what grape you had planted, because sometimes the nurseries had just messed it up. You know, so you'd have a vineyard, or you would inherit a vineyard, and or you'd purchase land, and you had no idea what was growing out there. super old, super run down, you know, whatever. These people would come out and they'd be like, this is Chenin Blanc. This is Grenache. This is Tempranillo, without a doubt. And there have been times, even in recent findings, where people were growing and selling a whole lot of grapes and completely were mislabeling what it was. So very, very important science. Little fun fact here for ampelography, little takeaway. If you ever wanted to identify Cabernet Sauvignon in a vineyard, it's actually one of the easiest to identify because it has punch hole designs in the leaf's lateral sinuses. So if you see on the picture I got right here, these little punch holes, those are the sinuses, lateral sinuses. And then this is up here, the petiolar sinus, where the petiole attaches to the leaf. Yeah, so it just looks like a little cookie cutter. It's adorable. Looks just like that. You can't miss it. Yeah. And Cabernet Franc even has a really similar look to it, too, because they're related. So, but Cabernet Sauvignon is the most distinct punctual lateral sinuses. So, yeah. Fun fact. A little party trick for you. Okay. Most common wine varieties in California. Typically, what you'll see are Cabernet Sauvignon, Tempranillo, Barbera, Zinfandel, Pinot Noir. So, really big hitters. Whites for California include Chardonnay, Sauvignon Blanc, and Pinot Gris. If you are interested in learning more about what each region grows, how much it sells for, and their tonnage, you can check out this Grape Crush report. I got a link here. So oftentimes in my slideshows, I'll post links to things that are related on that slide. Those aren't required. They're more for your general curiosity. If you'd like to learn more or dig deeper, that's just kind of for you. There are a few exceptions where at times I'll post a video that you should watch, and I'll let you know. Let you know when we get there. Cool. But that's just for fun. Okay, special class of grapes, the Tinturier. So, as you might know, you might not know, and that's okay. So, for red wines, it's the reason that it gets that color is because it's fermented on the skin. We don't just, you know, crush grapes and then ferment the juice. If you wanted to, you could, but it would have no color or very little color. But Tinturier is a very special class of grapes that the pulp is actually already red. And two examples of that is Alicante Boucher and Ruby Red. There are others, but those are just two for your enjoyment to look up if you'd like. If you see in this finger in the photo, that's actually like a purple stain on his hand from squishing the grapes. So yeah, it's actually not uncommon for vineyards to, you know, so say you have a block of Cabernet Sauvignon and you grow in an area where it's really hard for you to get good color in your wine. So it's actually not uncommon for people, if you go out into a vineyard, to plant like every 10 vines or whatever, every 50 vines, one Tinturier out there. Because most people aren't ampelographers anymore and don't know the difference. So you go out there, and that way when it's harvested all together, they call it cab, and it helps the color. Helps the color 100%. Or you could use it as a blender in a wine to help with color, or you could make it its own. There's a whole bunch of stuff. We'll get into that. But yeah, it's kind of interesting. Very cool. If you ever get a chance to try it, definitely try it as a wine. Okay, AVA, American Viticultural Area. So oftentimes if you buy a bottle of wine, it'll say the AVA on it, and that is a legal designation to benefit wineries and wine consumers for specific areas in the U.S. So there are actually over 107 AVAs in California alone. This is also known as an appellation, so if you know it as that, that's okay too. Different countries have different requirements on what qualifies as an appellation. It's, from what I've read, is mostly in place to prevent fraud. So an example of this would be, you know, say you are a winery owner in Napa Valley and you're trying to cut back on costs. If you were to go and buy grapes from El Dorado County and bring them in, and El Dorado County's grapes are not going to be as expensive because of the demand of wine is not as great as Napa. It doesn't have the world-renowned, you know, respect that Napa has yet, hopefully soon, because the wines are very good from that region. Anyways, the point is, they buy the grapes, they make the wine, right? The other day, they bottle it as Napa Valley, whatever, Tempranillo, Napa Valley Grenache. Well, now they're charging $150 per bottle, and they didn't even give El Dorado County any credit. Meanwhile, consumers don't even know, you know, they don't know the truth about where these grapes came from. In fact, some people really care about that because they'll want to support certain regions, or they're looking for a certain taste from a certain appellation. So yeah, it's mostly to prevent fraud. Yeah, you don't want to read a book by a fake author. You don't want to, you know, it's a whole thing. So yeah. Okay, different varieties will grow well in different regions and microclimates. So for example, for whites and lighter reds, and what I mean by lighter reds is like Grenache or Pinot Noir, like a lighter in color, lighter in body, kind of a style there. They're typically grown in cooler climates. So you know, Pinot Noir, Chardonnay, Riesling, typically find that on the coast. Darker reds or reds that really keep a high acidity, like Barbera is one of those grapes. Those grow well in hotter climates. So what we find is that grapes in hotter climates will lose acidity, and then grapes in cooler climates will keep their acidity. So one thing that's really common in California and some of our really hot regions is we actually have to add acid back into the wine after fermentation to get the levels right for the ratios than in much cooler climates or cooler parts of the world where they make wine. They actually have to put in something to the wine to decrease the acid, to deacidify it, because the cooler weather maintains the acid so well. We'll cover that later, but that's just like a little sneak peek. So for darker reds, keep their acidity, grow well in hotter climates. So example of that would be Barbera, Syrah, Zinfandel, Cabernet Sauvignon. Awesome. And you can also go back to the Grape Crush Report link I had up above if you're more curious, because it'll tell you the area and what exactly is grown, which is very cool. Okay. Top wine producers in the world as of 2018. Number one is actually Italy. 2, France. 3, Spain. And 4, the United States. Yeah, did not see that coming. I would have guessed France, but I have not traveled the world in a long time. So it's interesting to know, especially since Italy is so small. But yeah, there you have it. Pretty cool. And then there's some links if you want to check into that. Top wine producers in the USA as of 2018. California, numero uno. Washington, New York, Pennsylvania, Oregon. Texas is on the bottom at number 10. You got to be careful with these statistics because top wine producer is not the same as top grape producer or the area with the most acreage of grapes. So those can all be 3 completely different statistics because acreage, you know, you would assume a yield of grapes, but they actually cut back a lot. Wine producer could be someone who grows but also buys grapes and has a resulting higher amount of wine than other places, so gotta keep that in check when you look up stuff like that. Okay, economic impact. Yes, California is by far leading the United States for economic impact. Has 5 times more economic impact than any other wine-producing state in the United States. So California, $71.2 billion, and that was in 2017, so it's probably more now. New York behind at 13.8. And Texas actually number 3 at 13.1, even though they were 10th on the list of producers. So that was interesting. And yeah, let's go on down the list. Very cool. Wines of the world. Okay, so we're going to go through different winemaking regions around the world. And we're just going to touch on this very, very lightly. Like very lightly, because this is what your guys' is. Research papers are going to cover. So this is just kind of a very brief interlude. And then you'll go, the point is for this to interest you and then for you to go deeper and to write your paper about it. So yeah, that's why so little work was put into these slides. Okay. Wines of France. It's one of the largest producers in the world for wine, as we just found out. Winemaking has been traced all the way back to the 6th century BC. They have a very special system and laws for wine quality referred to as the AOC. I can't speak French, so I'm not going to attempt that. But since 2012, it's been replaced with the AOP. And this is very, very intense. It's way more intense than anything we have in the United States, is my understanding. This goes down to, how the grapes are grown, how the vines are trained, the amount of grapes that you can yield off of those vines every year, how the fermentation is handled, how it's bottled, the aging process. Like, it covers everything. It's very, very strict. So if you would like to get that, those credentials on your bottle in France, it's a very intense process. Also, The Judgment of Paris, if you haven't seen Bottle Shock, it's a really good movie. This was a historical turn of events for California wineries, particularly Napa, May 24th, 1976. So if you haven't seen that movie, definitely recommend it. It's when America beat France in a wine competition for the first time. It's pretty awesome. Okay, so specifically now we're going to the Rhone region of France. This is named Rhone because these are the hills that border each side of the Rhone River. These typically will have wider bottom-shaped bottles. Typical varieties are Syrah, Grenache, Mourvèdre, also known as Mataro, Cinsault, and Carignan. Whites for this region are typically Viognier, Marsan, and Roussan. So if you'd like to learn more about that, click on the link and you can check it out. It's very cool. So yeah, you see the bottoms of these bottles are wide. It's very pear-shaped. Remember that. Bordeaux. There are 5 traditional Bordeaux varieties, and that includes Cabernet Franc, Cabernet Sauvignon, Petit Verdot, Merlot, and Malbec. These typically contain a lot of high tannins, and they age for decades. So a lot of collectors of wine or people who trade will collect Bordeaux typically. And it's really, it's a beautiful thing. It takes a lot of patience, though. It takes a lot of patience to wait for the wine to age that long. These are typically better once they have opened up. I read that from a valuable source. I don't know if that's my 2 cents. I haven't been to France to taste their wines, but that's what Psalms are saying. So we'll see. I know typically in California, those varieties, I mean, you age it for a couple of years, but you can drink it after like 2 or 3 years. Anyways, okay. Burgundy, another region in France. So this is Pinot Noir, Chardonnay, Chablis are typically the main grapes grown there. The winery is traced back to the medieval times when Cistercian monks planted grapevines in walled vineyards called clos because they were attempting to stave off the plague. So it'd be very interesting if a winery were to do this with COVID. We're staving off COVID, so we're building walls. It's wonderful. Okay, Italy. Wonderful. Love it. Beautiful. Italy has over 500 native wine varieties. Crazy. Didn't know that. Sangiovese, Barbera, Malvasia, Bianca are just a couple of them. If you ever get a chance to try Malvasia, Bianca, do it because it's amazing. Some of all regions is over 1.7 million acres. They are known for their Super Tuscan, which is a very famous blend. It's typically Merlot, Cab Sauv, Sangiovese, Syrah, Cab Franc, and others. Chianti, which you see in the upper corner right here in a straw basket, that's a very, very common Italian blend. That has to be over 70% Sangiovese. It can have some Cab Sauv, Cab Franc, and other varieties in there. And yeah, it's typically in the squat bottle in a straw basket. Very cool. Oh, and what we have right here is a grapevine, believe it or not. So this is one way that they train grapevines along the coast in Italy. So this is, it's done in a small basket on the ground, and the grape clusters will actually grow on the inside. And this is to prevent it from harmful wind and salt from the ocean. So look it up. It's pretty cool. Yeah, we always see grapevines trained, either the traditional head training or the cordon, double cordon. In California, we don't really see this. So it's pretty cool And most people don't know it exists. So check it out. It's pretty cool. Okay, Spain. Spain contains the highest acreage of vineyards, but has a low grape yield. So that's what I was talking about earlier as far as the statistics. So Spain has the highest acreage, 2.4 million acres. Their famous blend is the Rioja. So if you ever hear that, it's a Spanish blend. And it's more than 70% Tempranillo, so Tempranillo-based. Carignan, Graciano, and Maturana Tinta. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. But yeah, that's typically what it's got going on. Spain is typically the home of Tempranillo, Graciano, Grenache, and other varieties. Castilla-La Mancha is their largest region. So if you're interested in that, you can write a paper about it. Argentina is one of my favorite places. Also, their largest wine region is Mendoza. And their most planted variety and most is most known from the region is Malbec. So Malbec from Argentina is a really big deal. Torontes is a native grapevine from Argentina. And this was the result of crossing Muscat of Alexandria and Mission grapes. So Muscat is typically made as a sweet wine. It's very floral, almost soapy sometimes if it's too intense. It's a very beautiful, robust white wine. Mission grape, I haven't had Mission on its own, but that is a really old grape. And anyways, crossed together, it's typically got like a whetstone character, maybe some rosemary. Kind of has the muscat nose from its mom. Anyways, it's a wonderful wine. If you ever get a chance to try it, it's amazing. It's typically made dry. It's very light. Love it. Totally great. Yeah, you'll love it too. Wines of Australia. Most planted varieties. Shiraz, which is just Syrah. It's the same thing. That's just what they call it over there. Chardonnay, Cabernet Sauvignon are big ones. Their main vineyard pests are kangaroos, surprisingly. Should not be surprising, though, because fruit and animals make sense. Most of their wines are bottled with screw caps, even the super premium wines. So there's kind of a sad stereotype going towards that with other parts of the world, including the United States, where screw caps is kind of made for cheap wine. But it's actually can be a lot more environmentally friendly and reduce waste, basically, because corks are coming from the bark of trees. And, you just have all this wood. And it can be a source of contamination, too. The corks can be. So, you know, there's really nothing wrong with screw caps. And it's nice to see a region challenge that stereotype. Yeah. So the climate is warm and dry. I've never been to Australia, but someone who did an internship there told me it is a lot like California. So take their word for it. Wines of New Zealand. Okay, New Zealand Sauvignon Blanc. Famous worldwide because it has a grapefruit character, so remember that. They are also known for Pinot Noir, Chardonnay, and Pinot Gris. So that's not all they make. They don't just make Sauvignon Blanc. And New Zealand is also amazing because they're kind of a new player on the map. They've been recognized for a little while now, but they're really bringing a new force to the industry because they are taking this sustainable, very sustainable approach to things. So 98% of their vineyards are certified sustainable. If you are curious about the requirements, I have a link for you. You can check it out, or you can write about it in your paper. It'd be very cool. And there are nearly 50,000 acres planted across the country. So very cool. Okay, moving on to just a little bit of wine history, and then we're going to be finishing up. I know I've got like 7 minutes left. Okay, where does wine come from? The origin of wine predates written texts, so it's really uncertain when the cultivation of grapes began. But when archaeologists find traces of tartaric acid in urns, this is a major indication that wine was present in those. So tartaric acid, we're going to learn about in this class, it's a natural acid that's found in the grapes themselves, and it's very stable. So it precipitates out of wine sometimes. We'll talk about that later. But anyways, it's extremely, extremely stable. So it lasts forever. So when they find it, it's, like 99.9% indicative that wine was in that vessel. Anyways, Wine often has ties to religion because of the altered state of consciousness that wine induces. It was also used for medicinal purposes because wine cannot carry any human virus or bacteria. So that doesn't mean that the glass can't or the vessel it's in hasn't been infected, but because wine has such a low pH, it actually can't transmit human virus or bacteria. So you can make really bad wine. You'll never kill anyone unless they choke on it. I mean, that's something else completely. But that's a wonderful thing about wine. The pH is very low. It's typically around 3.6, 3.4. So, yeah, fun fact. There you go. Okay, Armenia. Why are we talking about Armenia? It was the earliest evidence of steady wine production. So this is called Arini 1. It's a cave in Armenia, and it contained a wine press, fermentation vats, jars, and cups. And this is pretty amazing. They also found Vitis vinifera seeds and vines. So those are Vitis vinifera, that's the genus and species of the grapevines that we use for winemaking today. So that's a pretty big deal. So they found evidence of all these things. So this is the first like winery that they found in history with this archaeological dig. And this was 900 years before the earliest comparable wine remains were found in Egyptian tombs. So that's a pretty big deal. So Egyptians were maybe not the first to make wine. Okay, Phoenicia. What is Phoenicia? It's an ancient civilization along the Mediterranean Sea, stretching through what is now Syria, Lebanon, and northern Israel. Phoenicians were key in distributing wine, wine grapes, and winemaking technology throughout the Mediterranean region. They are known for their talent in shipbuilding, glass dyeing, and production of dyes. They were known as the Purple People because they manufactured purple dye for robes of Mesopotamian and Egyptian royalty, as well as in the Roman Empire. Crazy. Yeah, so you can see, if you blow this up, this is Phoenicia right here, this orange little noodle right here. And then this purple route, those were their trade routes. So they are very well probably responsible for bringing wine and grapevines to Italy and Greece and Spain. Maybe, oh no, sorry, that's Iberia. I don't know my maps. I'm sorry, it's late. I'm tired. Anyways, yeah, they're responsible for a lot, which is fantastic. They are most known for how they created a way to transport wine by amphora. Plural would be amphorae. That's plural. These were ceramic, and they're considered tableware that sat close to a table and was intended to be seen. Related to the pithos, which was much larger in capacity, up to 1.5 to 2.5 tons. Fantastic. This guy right here is a pithos. Okay, Egyptian beliefs with wine. This is pretty cool. So wine had important roles in Egyptian ceremonial life. Red wine in particular, resembled the blood of those who had battled against the gods and had fallen to the earth. They believed that grapevines had sprung from there. So this was the reason also that they thought that drunkenness drove men out of their senses because they were filled with the blood of their forebears. Very interesting. Fun fact. Ancient Greece. Dionysus, the Greek god of wine, also known as the giver of unmixed wine. So he did not, he had a heavy pour, which is fantastic. Homeric mythology, wine was served in mixing bowls, typically was cut with water. And that's probably because it wasn't very good then, would be my guess. They had to cut it back with something because it was just so strong, or maybe it was more close to vinegar. I'm not quite sure. But a lot of the modern wine culture that we have today is derived from ancient Greeks. And Greeks may have been responsible for introducing Vitis vinifera vines to Egypt, Sicily, France, and even Spain. So we're not quite sure about that, but it's still really cool. As far as the modern wine culture, you think about it, some people do drink alone, but oftentimes when we drink wine, it's with someone else or it's in celebration, it's done together. It's typically done as a relaxation. So a lot of that, came from the Greeks and, their view of, they just kind of go out into a forest and, enjoy life and drink and eat grapes and, yeah. So Very cool. Anyways, let's wrap this up. We're almost at 50 minutes. Here are your review questions. So, these are not due. Do not turn these into me. We're totally fine. This is for you and you only. So, what I would do is I'd print these out. I'd answer them at the end of every video so that way you're up on task with everything. And then keep it, make a little book for yourself, and that's a pretty good study guide for the exam. So, you should be good. Alrighty, well, that concludes lecture one. If you have any questions, reach out to me through Canvas or reach out through the email that I supplied on the syllabus, and we'll continue recording. It's going to be a good semester. I'm very excited. You should be excited. You're going to learn a lot. You're going to be talking about wine all the time, and it's going to be good. So, yeah. All right, I'll see you guys next time.